Our next speaker is an independent Scrum taker on a journey of humanizing the workplace with Scrum. His agile adventure started with extreme programming and Scrum in 2003. Years of dedication followed, spent on employing Scrum in diverse circumstances with various teams. He founded Ulysses Inc. in 2013 and co-created Agility Path, evidence-based management, and the Nexus framework for scaled professional Scrum. He is the author of the acclaimed books, Scrum: A Pocket Guide and 97 Things Every Scrum Practitioner Should Know. Ken Schwaber recommends Wunter's Pocket Guide to Scrum as the best description of Scrum currently available. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm delighted to introduce Wunter Verheyen.
Hey, thank you very much, Joanna, for the introduction and also highlighting the couple of books. Yeah, and indeed, imagine. Good afternoon, everybody, at least if this is afternoon for you guys. I hope we've got people from across the world. And it's with all of these Zoom things happening and connecting with people across the world, it's difficult to find the right introduction, right? I don't know whether you found that. I regularly have people in meetings and sessions across the world. And then you would say, oh, good afternoon, us not working. Good day. Sometimes even that doesn't work if you have people from, I don't know, Australia, New Zealand around, because it's often the middle of the night for them. So anyhow, I live in Belgium, in Antwerp, and been working with Scrum for quite a while, 17 years exactly. Started out in 2003. And as I, for the occasion of Scrum turning 25 years old this month, So I thought about a little bit about my life of Scrum, and I was a little bit intrigued still by the fact that my life of Scrum didn't start with Scrum. It started a long time ago with something called extreme programming. And I still have highly fond memories of those days. Now, still here to talk about Scrum a little bit and some viewpoints on Scrum. Because what I noticed certainly over the past couple of years, and I don't know how is that in your region, so I operate a lot with people from the globe, from around the globe, Europe, and very specifically often Belgium and certainly a lot in the Netherlands. I'm a Belgium guy, but I work a lot in the Netherlands. And over the past few years, more and more people are looking to use Scrum in, let's say, the non-traditional Scrum environments, meaning it's not really IT work, it's not even software development, it's not really product development or new product development, it's different things. Education, government services, I've had people from youth and childcare services, and they are often a little bit estranged by our sort of focus on what we call development. And we try to explain that it's not just coding, it's not just programming, it's not just even software development, it's development in general. You know, the roots of the new product development came, those things. But still, it makes it difficult for them. And also sometimes what I noticed, that's sort of the second finding, a lot of people get stuck on interpreting the rules and the exactness of the words of the Scrum guide. I'm like, yeah, but what about the intent? What about the purpose of those words? What about understanding and explaining that and acting upon that? So thanks to this horrible COVID thing, at least a couple of good things came out of it. In fact, I've now embraced totally online teaching, and it works like a charm, much to my own surprise and initial skepticism, honestly, but it's really working out fine. Another thing I did is already in March and April, I thought about how about helping those people that want to get across the rules of Scrum, how to sort of get them unstuck with Scrum, and at the same time, how to reach out to people that are using Scrum in very different environments. So I wrote this paper called Moving Your Scrum Downfield. And I thank you very much to the organizers of Agile Lean Ireland for inviting me to do this keynote for you guys and inviting me to talk about this paper. But this is a bit of the background. So Scrum expanding beyond the traditional things. And then starting to think about this, I try to think about what are now sort of essential traits to the game of Scrum. Yeah? You know, the idea of Scrum, the name Scrum comes from the new product development game, sort of the analogy with a team sports like rugby. A team moving as a unit on the field. And that's important. So that's sort of that comparison. I try to expand it a little bit. So what should be in the way you play the game of Scrum once you're on there on the field? Besides understanding the rules and what should be at play, and in that sense, what should be almost exhibited, demonstrated in the way that you play the game. And those are the six traits that I would love to take you guys through. And I hope they give you a little bit of a additional or a different perspective if on Scrum, because they should be in your game. And let's say from observation, if I can see them in your game, it's sort of an indication how you make Scrum come alive, how you are actually moving your Scrum downfield rather than still standing, still fighting the old enemies, the old adversaries of bureaucracy, rigid structures, rigid behaviors, and so on. So let me take you through them. So when thinking about these things in that paper, I've had different sort of definitions of Scrum throughout the years. Nothing is fixed, nothing is stable. Keep thinking, quite important. This is the bottom one, is the definition that drove me when I created this paper. And I've called it Scrum, a simple framework that enables people to derive value from complex challenges. It's sort of on the edge of being too complicated, but at least it has four aspects that I feel are very important. Scrum, and that's why I'm bringing this here, the simplicity of Scrum. Scrum is simple, that's the first trait. Scrum is simple yet sufficient, meaning it's a simple framework. Try to not overcomplicate it, overload it, add practices and things to it, stack things on top of it. It will lose its lightweight and it will make it less unfit to help you deal with complex challenges, because you can't fight complexity with complexity. That will end up in some sort of chaos. So simplicity, complex, important. The purpose of Scrum, value. I'll come back on that, but value is a very different driver than volume is. A lot of organizations are still stuck in thinking, yeah, let's use Scrum and just do more. What about doing the right stuff and not just more? That's sort of the idea. And the fourth element is it's all about people. It's all about people, people demonstrating accountabilities. It's quite important. So those are the aspects that I wanted to be in. I hope you have a sense of why. And that's more than just rules. It's people that will make Scrum come alive. Now, in a nutshell, and again, simplicity, trying to capture that simplicity, it just means a Scrum Master fosters an environment, so focusing on the environment, boundaries, and so on, in which people demonstrating accountabilities act and behave in a certain way. Sort of the rules of the game, the simple rules of the game, the rules that we should best apply. Now, there's one little thing I've done with my paper. In my struggle to reach out to people from a non-software, non-IT, non-product development background even, they struggle with the term development team. So I've taken the liberty, this is not official, this is not to overrule anything else, but I've taken the liberty to call what is typically called in Scrum development team, call that the Scrum team. Again, the analogy with where Scrum comes from, team sports, in this case, rugby. And I took the right picture of having the Irish national team there, the rugby team. So the people moving as a unit on the field, the sort of the field players, I've taken the liberty to call them the Scrum team rather than development team, and not use a sort of name for the overall thing. So if you see me using Scrum team in this case, it would be what Scrum typically would call development team. I just like Scrum team more. It's more generic in a way. Yeah. And there's not one single term that will cover these days all activities where people are trying to use Scrum for. Yeah. So that's the first trait, the embracing the simplicity of Scrum. Playing by the rules, don't stack practices, additional things, phases, whatever on top of Scrum. Scrum is simple yet sufficient. Now, what is important for me, another aspect of Scrum, is beyond the rules and roles and the events and the artifacts and so on, let's say the formal elements of Scrum, which you see reflected on that game board over there. That game board, by the way, is from the book that Joanna introduced, my pocket guide to Scrum. I don't know whether you can see that. And on my game board, I wanted to represent not just the official elements of Scrum, but also some important principles underlying Scrum. Yeah? And what I call Scrum's DNA is that combination of self-organization and empiricism. Yeah? Empiricism meaning empirical process control or empirical management. And quite an important finding, now that Scrum is turning 25 years, we have achieved a lot. So thank you all very much for doing that, for making it happen. It's only thanks to practitioners like you guys out there on the work floor, applying Scrum, that Scrum has become so important, and that we've helped people see the value of empirical management over predictive management. So that's cool. What I see a lot of companies still struggling with is that aspect of self-organization. Yeah, and that is still important. And that's sort of what I call the people aspect of Scrum. Less the process aspect, but more the people aspect of Scrum. Yeah? And if I would look back on my game board, that first important principle of Scrum, it even goes back to the new product development game, if ever you would read that paper or have read it. In order to function properly, to self-organize, get the most out of your Scrum, it's a totally team-centric approach, hence the origins of the name. You need a space to work in as a team. And open office spaces are not that. Just to be completely clear, you need a team space, a shared workspace. Might be a team space, that might be a virtual team space if you're working in different locations. But as a team, you need that. You can't truly self-organize and get the most out of Scrum without that thing. So in that sense, my first principle is connected to the self-organization aspect. And why that aspect is so important, that self-organization aspect, because it has to do with the people aspect of Scrum. Now, I've been talking a lot lately. So one of the advantages of COVID writing that paper, I've also been invited to an enormous amount of online events. Only today, this morning, I've been speaking in Brussels, virtually here in Belgium. Today, speaking with you guys, tomorrow, speaking in Vietnam. I've been in India, and I didn't even have to travel. So let's sort of embrace that good thing too. It's at least good for the environment. So I've been talking a lot lately also about engagement of people, which is sort of different name, but a somewhat more positive name for what we call commitment in Scrum. The Scrum value of commitment. And it seems that across the world, at least, the levels of engagement of the workforce of people doing work in companies is horribly low. Meaning across the globe, there's about 15% of people, only 15% of people saying that they're actually engaged for the company, that they feel motivated, inspired, committed to go for their company. Now, there's some variations across the world. I live in Belgium, that is Western Europe. We do even worse than at the global scale. People in Ireland might be not too optimistic either, because it's not really a lot better, honestly. You can look at the regions. Now, regardless of those figures, even if you would assume that the 31% of the US and Canada would be really true, even then, it means that still 70 up to 85 more percent of people indicate that they are not engaged, and worse, even actively disengaged, so negatively engaged, undoing the work of the positively engaged people. So there is a problem with the people aspect in our organizations, because people don't buy into the future, the vision, the mission statement, the whatever of their companies. This is a good reminder for me why maybe who knows, the next 25 years of Scrum should be more about that people aspect of Scrum. We have gotten the idea of empirical management, inspection, adaptation, feedback, small cycles, lots of feedback loops. That is getting true. How about that second aspect of Scrum's DNA? That's for me a quite important one. So just think about it, because the potential is immense. It is huge. 85% of the workforce. Now there's a huge potential of trying to get those people to engage again for their companies. Imagine the beautiful world that would be. Now, simplicity of Scrum. It has accountability Scrum. Those accountabilities are important. They're also tied into the people aspect of Scrum. So not just the empiricism, but also the people aspect of Scrum. It's people performing accountabilities. And not just performing, but more demonstrating accountability. That should be the goal, and to create an environment with Scrum where the people actually demonstrate accountability rather than having to be held accountable or asking them to show accountability. Create an environment with boundaries in which people show, demonstrate accountability proactively. Yeah, be inspired. And we already know that Scrum is a lot about what we call moving authority down the line. So I've also been looking into research, that was from the Boston Consulting Group, about people in management positions. So if you see low levels of engagement with, let's say, the workforce, actually the same low levels of engagement in a way also exist with people in a management position. And when asked for, how do you think management should look like then? If you're not happy the way it's organized now, how do you think it should look like? And the fascinating thing is that those people asked for what ideally management should be about, that is, can be perfectly mapped on the accountabilities of Scrum, meaning working as teams, helping people develop their skills, work with feedback, grow teams, eliminate obstacles like removing impediments, yeah, and be a team rather than telling people what to do. Set goals, help people make decisions rather than having to implement upon decisions that are being made for them. So in that sense, all of that management activities of, let's say, the modern manager should maybe not be no longer in one person only that has power and exerts. Power and is all about hierarchy. We've got what managers say ideally should happen. We've got that in the accountabilities of Scrum. We've got a product owner managing the product, managing the what needs to be done, optimizing the what for delivering value. Again, not volume. The most important stuff delivered when it is needed, not when we thought it was going to be needed in like 12 months' time or so. Yeah. Now, there's a separation of accountabilities. That separation of accountabilities says that we've got, in my terms, the Scrum team in general, the players on the field, on the pitch, Scrum team's development team, creating done increments, meaning converting some of the what from the product owner via a how into done releasable versions of products or services. Yeah. That's also another point when working with people in a non-typical Scrum environment, to help them think in terms of what we call product in Scrum. It's not just a physical product or a software product. It can be a service or a collection of services. So creating releasable versions of products or services. Yeah, it's quite important. So and there's obviously some sort of tension between the what and how. The person for the what wants to do more, and then the Scrum team's accountable for the how. So yeah, but we can only do so much. From that separation of accountabilities and the tension arising from that, upon good collaboration, they should figure out what to do together. So that's also demonstrating accountability. And you know what? They might have some help with the Scrum Master. So it's not a master, it's not a boss, it's not a boss of the people, it's a master of Scrum. Those two words cannot be separated. Yeah, facilitating the game, helping people understand the game, and so on. Helping people develop themselves. Again, Scrum Masters, that people aspect. So the sort of the people in the process, that is so important. Three, peer accountabilities. Nobody owns any of the other accountabilities. They should complement each other. And by developing new relationships with each other, they should also, again, moving authority down the line, develop better, improved relationships. That's also demonstrating accountability with people outside of their team or their product or service ecosystem, meaning stakeholders within the organization, consumers, end users, buyers, you name it. Customers. So and again, not about hierarchy. It's about helping those people do a better job, providing input from certain perspectives like strategy, strategic directions, company visions, company strategies, and so on for stakeholders, consumers from actual usage of the product. That's quite important. So again, management ideally says a survey should be about this and not about trying to control individuals. No. We can expect to create an environment in which those players demonstrate accountabilities. And from that demonstration of accountabilities, start seeing leadership as a shared quality, a shared ability, more than pure hierarchy or power. Yeah? And like I said, it's about value. So we've got a what of value defined by the product owner, ordered by the product owner, and managed by the product owner. It's a core purpose of Scrum to deliver more value. And in that sense, I even like to take it a step further. One of the accountabilities that we have in Scrum as a whole system is to optimize for value. And value is not volume. It is not utilization. It is not capacity planning. It is not keeping people busy. It is not trying to upfront fill every possible hour of the sprint at the end of sprint planning. No. It's looking for the most important work, the most important work that will have the highest impact. And impact is outcome. So increment in terms of Scrum, that is output. Output is not enough. You should create output, otherwise you can't have outcomes. But it should be the outcomes of the output, meaning in terms of value. What is the value that we're increasing? Value for users, consumers, stakeholders, for the organization, also value for the people doing the work. So and Scrum is all about creating a flow of value. Potentially. That's why you want to order your product backlog for value. That's why things that are still far away in time, don't spend too much time on them, but start picking them up and maybe detail them more as they come closer. Maybe it's a good idea to have your product backlog being filled with business challenges and expectations and solutions, problems that users and consumers are experiencing, rather than already sort of IT types of requirements. And then order them for value. So as they come closer, they get pulled into a sprint, yeah, and they get sort of pulled into the Scrum system. Now the Scrum system, the system of Scrum, could consist of one team, single team Scrum, or multiple teams, multi-team Scrum. That makes no difference. The goal of Scrum is at the end to create releasable versions of your product or your service, so that you can put them into the market, that you can close the feedback loop with your consumers, that you can finally validate that your assumption of value was correct or not correct. So it's about validating or invalidating. Until you do that, you have no idea whether you are actually delivering value or not. It's an assumption until you really go to the market, go to your users, and close that feedback loop. Closing the feedback loop obviously also means not just releasing, but also capturing feedback, measuring feedback in some way. And so all of the transparency in Scrum, transparency over the work ordered on the product backlog, the way it's ordered, should be visible why the work is ordered like it is, based on importance and then create value. So it's not just about transparency, it's also about flow. And what turned out in terms of value from that survey from the Gallup Institute that I referred to about the low levels of engagement. Now, the Gallup Institute has also been comparing in their survey companies with high levels of engagement versus companies with sort of low levels of engagement. And differences in what I would call outcome. Yeah? And they've seen in three domains. First of all, business and customer outcomes, which we would typically, or a lot of organizations, enterprises would typically look at. Sales figures, customer satisfaction, financial benefits, profits, revenues, some sort of returns, potentially even cost cutting, market share, competition being angry with us, I don't know, things like that. In those terms, those companies perform a lot better, which is cool, great. But what even is more important, in those companies, the turnover of staff is a lot less. So people leave the company less, even leave the region less. What happens in other companies and regions, by the way, with low levels of engagement. So turnover of staff is less. Illness is a lot less. Long-term absenteeism is a lot less. Burnouts, depressions, you name it, all of the things that we see so much around us, it's so much better. So it has better business and customer outcomes, but even better, it's a better place to work at. It's a more humane workplace. Now think back of only 15% of the workforce is really engaging. So relate that now to optimizing for value. So invest some time, that's my advice, to look at the environment. How engaged are people? You've got to sprint retrospective for that. And spend more time. Again, the self-organization aspect of Scrum, this people aspect of Scrum, there is so much potential for improvement. So and improve your environment, increase engagement, try to get people to think, to act upon intrinsic motivation again, rather than extrinsic motivation being pushed around all the time to breathe down their necks. And they will demonstrate accountability, and that demonstration of accountability will result in better business and customer outcomes. So that's quite important. And obviously, Scrum's DNA, the people aspect, self-organization, hugely important. Scrum is built upon it, on the fact that complex problems, complexity, unpredictable, uncertain problems can only be tackled by people using their intelligence, their creativity, collectively. It's not superhero things. Working as a team, working through different difficult problems, different options, figuring out what to do at the right point in time. Now, the other aspect of Scrum is obviously the empirical process control, empiricism. It means closing the loops. But maybe I'm just lucky. My life of Scrum didn't start with Scrum. It actually started with extreme programming. And probably early on, as from 2003, that helped me realize that you need more feedback loops than just, let's say, the official feedback loops of Scrum. Now, the official feedback loops of Scrum help us move away from open loops. In an open loop system, you have input, it goes to the system, you have outcome or output, and that's it, end of discussion, and it should all be perfect. That means your input should be already perfect. The plan to work upon that input should be perfect. Otherwise, you're going to fail miserably. Hence, short explanation why the waterfall approach doesn't work on complex and unpredictable work, because open loops assume high levels of predictability. We don't have that predictability. That's why you need a closed loop system. And Scrum implements that from a sort of external perspective, so beyond those three accountabilities and the players. So the input into Scrum is product backlog, ordered for value, hopefully, not about utilization, but discovering, uncovering the most important work. And then players demonstrating accountabilities, product owner and Scrum team and X development team, figuring out how to transform that into releasable, valuable increments. And there might be a next step to do more than just produce releasable increments. Releasable means technically fit, in a good shape, they will hold, not break, everything's been tested as it should have been, and so on, and put that into the market. I think there's something more we can do. Try to think of valuable increments, not just technically releasable. Yeah? And then gather feedback, collect feedback. Compare that to what you want to do, what are changing views, what are changing expectations, new challenges, and so on. Product backlog being a living artifact. But this is how Scrum, as at the highest level, meaning a sprint, closes the loops. Now, obviously, within a sprint, we've got the daily Scrum as an additional feedback loop within a sprint. And that's indeed quite important. So, but overall, looking at the sprint, at the beginning of the sprint, we're going to have a sprint planning. Sprint planning is sort of a mixture of talking about the what, identifying, selecting what are we going to do from product backlog, converting that into a how, and driven by a why, the overall sprint goal. So there's a why. So the whole sprint is about what, how, and why. Throughout the sprint, the focus is more on the how. What are we going to do? Sort of work. So less on discussions on how does it look like, what should it be. So more from what to from how to what. And by the end of the sprint, we close the loops by again from our ambition of why we were doing sprint. Again, compare, look back at what did we decide to do against our why and how did we do that? Yeah. So closing the loops with Scrum at a sprint level means that within a sprint, we've got a daily Scrum as an additional feedback loop. So a short sort of feedback loop to keep the overall loop better in line helps us better make better progress towards the identified why. But there's probably more. And this is not really in line with people not in software development, but I'm going to assume that a lot of you are in software development or in IT types of work, software product development. So these are practices, development practices, if you want. You need them in Scrum. That's sort of what I remembered from my days of extreme programming, and afterwards always trying to combine Scrum with extreme programming practices. You need good development practices because good development practices give you additional feedback loops within a sprint. They quickly show you, they give you feedback. Is this right? Not right? Are you going in the right direction? Should you redo something? Should you refactor stuff? I don't know. So you recognize a lot of those practices from extreme programming. And on top of that, even within a sprint, you need additional feedback loops. And my preference is for those additional, let's say, feedback loops that come from your development practices, that they are even shorter feedback loops than the daily Scrum. So you've got a sprint, a daily Scrum, and on top of your daily Scrum, you have multiple shorter feedback loops. And you need those feedback loops. In a way, a sprint for me is sort of a nicely tuned sort of construction composition of a number of feedback loops. And that's important. It's all about feedback. It's all about closing the loops in order to optimize for value. And the last, the sixth essential trait for me of Scrum is the Scrum values. So in my little pocket guide that Joanna talked about back in 2013, I described the Scrum values. I had described them a year earlier on my blog, my website. It's the most read blog notes ever on my website, and I will never be able to create something that will have the same sort of success of this being read so much. So people see value in the values. They understand how the Scrum values are in themselves quite valuable. Now, Scrum has feedback loops, practices, meetings, rules, roles, accountabilities in place. All those things, let's call them Scrum practices in general, they go hand in hand with the values. It's not first the values and then the practices. It's not first the practices, then the values. They go hand in hand. So don't be led astray by that sort of silly confusion that people try to create. It's apply Scrum, follow the rules, feel, experience what that does with regards to commitment, focus, openness, respect, courage, and so on. So they go hand in hand. And that's how I look at the Scrum values. If you would attend a class by me, you would notice that, much to people's surprise, I don't focus on the values explicitly because they're woven in throughout my classes, in all of the behaviors, because I feel that's the power of the Scrum values. They translate into tangible, actionable behaviors. And for me, they serve two purposes. They sort of form a compass that gives us direction in our behaviors. And at the same time, they're also sort of barometer, sort of indication of the healthiness of our Scrum. In a way, as people, organizations, teams start adopting Scrum more and more and more, For me, you should be able to see those values in a way taking precedence, more in people's behavior. So less than the rules, more about values. Because in the end, Scrum is more about behavior than it is about process. So that are for me six essential traits. And again, like the sort of false dichotomy that people would use, first the traits, then Scrum, no, hand in hand. I just hope that people see that there's more than Scrum than just the rules. And that even if you're stuck at interpreting the rules, maybe thinking in terms of these traits might help you get over that and get more from Scrum. Sort of. Thanks very, very much for listening. I think Joanna, if that works out, we might do a couple of questions. So please, everybody, just keep your openness, keep learning, keep improving. That's what Scrum is about. It's not just about delivering more and more and more. So in a sense, keep scrumming. It's a verb more than a process.
Thank you very much, Wunder. Your talk nicely links to the lots of talks we had yesterday about people value and, you know, people being centered on everything what we're doing. We indeed have few questions, and I combine few of them. So three of them I will just combine in one. Somebody is asking how and who needs to deal with actively disengaged people. But there is a similar question: how do you do it when your team consists of mainly contractors and vendors? And then, and then the third question, very, very similar, is how to do it in the company that is very fixed minded, you know, set in their ways of working, and they didn't stretch that muscles for years. So they are very much in the comfort zone. So if you could help us with that.
Yeah. Well, first of all, try to get more out of that self-organization aspect. That is going to take quite some time. Because for years and years and years, like people indicate, we have denied people the right to organize their own work. So it's going to take a while. The biggest problem often is that I've worked with quite some teams that became what I call highly collaborative. So I like highly collaborative teams more than high performing teams, sort of still old school industrial thinking. And every time again, sort of their motivation went down again, because results were not good enough according to external people, and they started interrupting again, and sort of the impatience of management and leadership. So that might ruin the whole thing. And what does the impatience also come from? Because they don't see results quickly enough? Yeah, that's right, because for a few decades and longer, we have denied people the right to organize their own work. So we now come in saying, this is Scrum, this is about self-organization. Yeah, that's what they said in the past also. So it's going to take a while. That's one aspect. Another aspect is sometimes you work with what you have. You use Scrum to get the most out of what you have. If it's all contractors, if it's all just people coming to work to spend their days sort of 9 to 5, you try to create an environment that inspires them, but it's not going to work for everybody. Some people might leave because you want to focus on commitment more. Sometimes you would just want to leave it as it is. And maybe as a Scrum Master, you would want to leave yourself. That's not what I was hoping for. So sometimes it is what it is. It sounds very fatalist, I don't know, but sometimes you use Scrum to get the most out of the circumstances that you have in the constraints that you're working within. But at least for me, always important is the sprint retrospective. So I had questions, I wrote about it a while ago. So you introduced my two books, Joanna. So Frank, I'm in the meantime also working on a third book, and it's gonna be in that book also. That question from people, Gunter, how can you have more fun retrospectives? And I'm like, yeah, you know, fun, all fine. But what about sort of professional fun? What about engaged retrospective? So this is Scrum. It's a sprint retrospective. It's something from Scrum. So at least, I don't know if anybody can see, but in the back of my home office, I've got this fish bowl there. something I drew to help people think about what should we talk about at the retrospective? Well, let's make it a Scrum retrospective. So talk about, did we deliver value? Did we deliver a done increment? But also things about team engagement. How did we feel as a team? How did we feel about stress levels and our levels of engagement? And what can we potentially do about that? Yeah. So the Scrum Master has a role to play. Now, the problem is in that sort of utilization, industrial way of using Scrum, people seem to be tired as the retrospective begins. They're just happy that the sprint is over. They just stumbled across the finish line, already happy that they just quickly want to go home. So there's something not really working out, not really sustainable. But a sprint retrospective should be at least about team engagement and the increment as it was shared and demonstrated at the sprint review. And beyond that, how do we feel as a team? And if those questions and the ability for people to act upon potential improvements for themselves, if that doesn't inspire people, then maybe you just have to accept what it is. Do your best, and if you're really not happy, maybe do something else. But at least the retrospective gives you a tool, an instrument as a Scrum Master, at least to at least get some sense of engagement by the end of every sprint, and then try to do something about it and help people develop themselves.
Thank you very much, Gunter. I'm very conscious of the time. So just one more question. So is it possible to do Scrum with fixed dates?
Yes. Yeah, because in your product backlog ordering, there's an ordering. So it's a sequence stream. So there's actually a sort of timeline running through that. And by the end of every sprint, you get some view of what might be possible by when. So if your date is fixed, then by the end of every review, potentially you have an update available of by that date, what might be potentially possible. The danger is that people start twisting quality again to reach a date. And in Scrum, officially, normally, you wouldn't be able to do that because you've got a definition of done in place. So next to development practices and standards, definition of done is a very important standard that we're sticking to. So by the end of sprint, all work should be done, meaning compliant with our definition of done. So in that sense, you're going to adjust scope and content and whatever to then never change quality. And then you might balance that against dates.
Okay. Thank you very much for your time, Gunter. We are at the time now, we will need to finish. However, on the right-hand side, there's a discussion panel. If you, like some of our speakers kind of went through those questions and replied to them, and if you could spend a few minutes doing that would be great, then people can go later and have a look. Yeah. That would be really appreciated. And for everybody attending this talk, please go back to the discussion panel later at the end of the day and go through the answers. Thank you very much for the talk. It was very, I would say enjoyable, but it was more than enjoyable. There was, we got out a lot of learning out of it, which is the most important. Thank you. Thank you very much, Gunter.
Thank you for having me, and thank you for everybody attending and listening. I hope it may have provided a little bit of inspiration about Scrum.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye-bye all.